Are we recording?
Yes, we are.
Thank you.
Okay. give me okay. All right, here we go. All right. Got it. Welcome, everyone. We have a very exciting program for you coming up. The title of the program is The Power of Telling Our Stories Using the Arts. And, you know, this week you've heard a lot of people talking about, you know, how to tell our story using the film, using, you know, performing arts. And so we're going to hear a little more about those details and how that we can use film art and performing arts to create a meaningful personal narrative to tell the story. And can you please mute your phones if you're not speaking? Thank you. So I'd like to introduce our moderator and panelists. Our moderator will be Larissa Lam. Larissa is the director of the award-winning film, Far East, Deep South. She was part of the Smithsonian History Film Forum Emerging Filmmaker Lab, and her work has been featured on NBC, PBS, and NPR. Prior to career in film, she was award-winning singer, songwriter, and composer, who wrote music for film and TV shows like The Oprah Winfrey Show. She is also a TV radio host, motivational speaker, who has presented TEDx, LeaderCast, Yale, MIT, and her alma mater, UCLA. We also have Baldwin Chu. Baldwin and his family are the subjects of the film Far East, Deep South, on which he serves as producer. He is also known as a hip hop artist, Only One. And many of you may have seen his viral music videos, Cantonese Boy, I Like to Eat Dim Sum, and Asian Americans Make History. He graduated from the Act One Film Producing Program and is a professionally licensed mechanical engineer and was previously a spokesperson for the White House Engineering Program under the Obama administration called Stayed With It. We also have Rusty Chan. Rusty is currently the vice president of, he is the secretary on the National Lodge. And he is currently also the president of the Albuquerque Lodge and involved in the performing arts. So Larissa, I will hand it over to you.
Well, thank you. Well, thank you so much, Melanie. I hope everybody is having a good afternoon wherever you are. It's so great to be with our fellow CACA brothers and sisters. I'm actually part of the SGV Lodge in San Gabriel Valley. And Baldwin, you are part of
LA.
So we have a split household, which there's actually a couple of us, couples that are in that same boat. But we are so glad to be joined by Rusty, our Albuquerque buddy. And we are going to have a discussion about storytelling and kind of its effectiveness, and even maybe give you ideas as how you know, maybe you're not an artist or a creative, but how you can partner with artists and creatives, or even have an idea that can come to life to be able to effectively communicate a story. Because the bottom line is, what we want to do is we want to do a better job and have new avenues to educate the public on our stories, whether it's family history or just general history in general from our communities. Okay, so earlier, if you just joined us, we did a little icebreaker earlier. You feel free to chime in too. I had asked everybody, what are some memorable movies or like plays or musicals that you've seen in the past? You can continue to populate the feed with that, and I'll mention that a little bit more later. But first off, I'm gonna start with kind of an opening question for Rusty and Baldwin here. Why are the arts an effective means of telling our stories? Baldwin, do you want to maybe start first?
Sure. Well, I think, you know, stories make things memorable. I think maybe you're alluding to that a little bit here. But I do remember when I was younger and I did not like history at all. And I think now, even if I'm honest, you know, even when we're talking about Asian American history, if I'm honest about it, Asians make up only 6% of the population. And I do find that probably the other 90%+ of America may not think that Asian American history is all that relevant or interesting at all. But what I found out was that after seeing films like ours, other films that have had API historical figures in it, and when people start learning about these through watching films, a lot of people I've encountered that would say to us at all these screenings, they say, like, we never cared about Asian American history or even
Asian Americans
or Asians even, right? I've had some people say, like, I really didn't think much about you guys. But after seeing films and seeing some of these things, I'm now actually very interested. So I think that's why that's probably one of the main things why I think storytelling is important for us.
Those are all really good points. Rusty, chime in here. Why are arts an effective means of telling stories?
Well, I think if you look at, like Baldwin was saying, in high school, if you do not like certain dry subjects, if you have found a special teacher that was very animated, we had a history teacher, I remember, his name was Mr. Rock, and he taught American history, and everybody fought to get into his classroom because he was just so funny. He would give you the facts, but then he would tell you like a little story that went along with the facts. And so it animated the lecture, it animated the lesson. And I think that that's really a huge important part, integral, in fact, about how the arts and telling stories and being very animated about that can bring these things to life and actually give context to things in a very immersive and even an emotional way that usually you don't get if someone just gets up there and says 144,000 Japanese were interned and they're blah, 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 you know, and that's very boring. But when you get someone up there that actually is acting or dramatizing something like that, it bypasses that in your brain.
Absolutely. And so now, to kind of illustrate both of the points that you guys were bringing up, I'm going to kind of read through some of the names of movies and musicals that people threw out to kind of illustrate that point. And if you have just joined us earlier, I'd asked everyone to put in the chat their favorite movie or musical, some of the memorable. So feel free, if you haven't had a chance to add it to the chat, feel free to add it to the chat. And so The Greatest Showman, someone mentioned, which is about P.T. Barnum. If you never knew about P.T. Barnum and the circus, like, this was a great, like, you would know more about his life through this. Joy Luck Club, which was a film that it was probably the first entryway for a lot of people, a window into kind of the Asian American experience, especially as Asian American women. Always Be My Baby is another listed with, and which is more recent. And again, it's another like film that, you know, people may not have realized, you know, it's like the first rom-com with like two true Asian leads in it. And you know, these are kind of watershed moments in a window in people's lives. Les Miserables, a couple of people mentioned that. There's of course the book, the play, the musical, major, you know, movie iterations of it. I loved Les Mis. I knew nothing about the French Revolution until I watched Les Miserables. And then all of a sudden I started doing research on the French Revolution. And you know, Wicked, slightly fictional, but if you want to learn about
witches and goodness and evil.
You know, Princess Bride, another fictional story, but very, very memorable. Gonna learn about that period, which is somewhat fictional. You can't. Breakfast at Tiffany's, which is what Elaine mentioned, and Sound of Music, both historical backdrops, right? You've got World War II, Nazi Germany as an issue with Sound of Music. And then Breakfast at Tiffany's, you know, as beautiful that story is, you've also got a situation where we have the opposite, is when you have other people telling stories and you cast Mickey Rooney as somebody who is Chinese, you've got a problem. And so this is also where, when we don't tell our stories and let someone else tell those stories, they come across as inaccurate or stereotypical. And so as memorable as Breakfast's Tiffany's is, think about how much more powerful it would even be if we didn't have to undo the damage that was done, because there's power positively, but there's also power in a negative way with storytelling. So a lot of Sound of Music fans. So, you know, Doe a Deer is also very, very whimsical and fun. I love Sound of Music. I've seen it a million times. But again, there's a historical drop, much more serious, you know, historical backdrop, which is a great entry point. So many other ones. Hamilton, if we have time later, we've actually used Hamilton. We did a song called Asian Americans Make History, where we put our own twist to one of the Hamilton songs. And so, you know, there's so many great movies. I learned more about horse racing because of My Fair Lady. And also the difference between British, different classes of British because of My Fair Lady. And so, as you can see, there's so many historical and cultural moments that are reflected through storytelling. And so as we kind of move into our discussion, we're going to share more about, you know, Rusty's experience and our experience and how you guys can all can maybe use it and promote these storytelling narratives. Okay, Rusty, we're going to talk a little bit about your experience next, but thank you everyone for contributing your thoughts in the chat. Tell us more about the play that you were involved in and telling about the Japanese internment. You know, tell us about where you performed the play and, you know, about the actors involved. We'd love to hear more.
Okay, so I was approached by a professor here at UNM. She had heard that I was very active back in the 80s. Going to school. My first degree is a bachelor's in fine arts, theater, acting emphasis with a minor in history and lighting design. So she approached me and she said, you know, I'm thinking about getting writing a grant to get some money to put on a show about Japanese internment in New Mexico. And of course, everybody just says Japanese internment in New Mexico. They have no context for that. And what they don't know is that specifically there wasn't a family camp here, but there was a Department of Justice camp that held all of the fathers and grandfathers of the Japanese Americans that were in the family camps. Not all of them, but many of them. And these were the so-called leaders of the community that were rounded up like virtually the day of and the day right after. And they were all shipped first to, I think, North Dakota. And then once they were all interrogated in North Dakota, they were shipped down here to Lordsburg. There was a camp down in Lordsburg. And then as the camp expanded in Lordsburg to include prisoners of war, the Italian soldiers, the German soldiers, and even some Japanese soldiers. They moved all of the guys that were down there, all the resident aliens and fathers of Japanese Americans, they moved all of them up to a new camp in Santa Fe. And so in Santa Fe, we just put a monument up about 15 years ago in the subdivision now, where the camp was. And what you find is a lot of misconception about those people and a lot of misconception about you know, Japanese Americans as a whole. And what this does when you take a play rather than a lecture to the people, is it you bypass some of their prejudices, I think, and you really are able to open up some of them. And of course, the ones that are very hardcore will always stay hardcore, but the ones who are on the fence and the ones who are ignorant will then be enlightened by the facts and the stories that you bring.
Yeah, and you know, that I think uncovering those little known stories and making it memorable through, you know, a dramatic depiction is really, really important. So what was the response from the community? And, you know, how long was the engagement for the play?
So the play has been done actually. So we've taken it several years. It started in 2016. I was first a part of it, but then I had to pull out because of some medical issues. But we then did it again 2017, 18, 19, and then we did it the first part of 2020. Unfortunately, the pandemic and the shutdown put the kibosh on all performances of it. But it started off as a play just to acknowledge what the Japanese Americans use as the Day of Remembrance, which is about, you know, being being put into the internment camps. And the people here in Albuquerque, we've usually put this on in a library that has an auditorium that's attached to it. And it's very important for this particular type of play to use a screen and to show slides up on the screen. And that gives not only context, but it can show, it can give, it can act as your set, because it can provide, you can say, oh, well, now we're in the desert, and you put up a picture of a desert, and then that's easier for people to, you know, to get into it. The response has been rather positive. We have people come to us and say, I never knew that there was a camp in Albuquerque, not Albuquerque, but Santa Fe. And other people that come in and say, you know, I'm a high school teacher. Can you please bring this to our high school students? And I actually think that this is a great way to bypass some of the restrictions that we have trying to get our stories into the curricula, right? So if you have to go past school boards and you have to go past, departments of education, where everybody tries to put up a roadblock, you can't put that into our textbook because that we get our textbooks from Texas. So, you know, all of that stuff has to run by the school boards in Texas in order to get to bypass that. You can say, well, then, can we bring in a show to show all your students? Or can we give you tickets and you have your students come into our theater space and view our show? And you can then if your play has a bit of scholarship to it, and because this was done with a PhD, was the playwright for this, it was, you know, all factually correct. And she was able to get agreements and cobble together stories from various different sources and books. And I'll actually show you, she actually got Jean Wakatsky to give her permission to perform a couple of scenes from Farewell to Manzanar. I don't know if anybody has seen that movie. But it was Jean Wakatsky's memoir about her time in the internment camp. So if you'll allow me to share my screen, I'll give you a quick PowerPoint. Using arts to tell the story. These are the performing arts, which are music, dance, and theater, as opposed to, say, the other arts, sculpture and painting. Many of our lodges use dance in that you have youth dance troupes that go out and either perform in the community or they perform for us and we invite the community in. There's music. Some people have musical groups that will perform Chinese music and or more modern things like what Baldwin and Lysra do with rap music. My presentation today is about theater and specifically the Japanese internment show that we did here in New Mexico. What people don't know is the history of Asians in America. We all know that this is sorely lacking. Any of us who have been through the educational system in America know that, for instance, for Chinese exclusion, we get about a paragraph in the history books. We don't even get a module. You don't even get a day or even a week to discuss it. Any organization can make use of theater to share the history of Asians and Asian Americans, AAPI. And in this case, I'm going to use the example of the show that I was in, Internment in the Land of Enchantment. How is theater different than film? Theater is different than film in that theater is ephemeral. theater must be presented in the same space and the same time. A film is usually done at a different time and presented at a different time in a different space. So for instance, you go to the theater and you see something on the film, My Fair Lady, which was done years ago, decades ago, right? The people that are in it are no longer alive. So they can't even get in your feedback anymore because they've passed away. And what's also different is that they can't change at all. What's done is done. It's on celluloid or it's digital, and it usually cannot be changed. The one example of that which can be changed in recent, I don't know if any of you have seen, prior to his selling of his franchise, the Star Wars franchise, to Disney, George Lucas would go out about every 10 to 15 years and revisit his films. And if he decided that something could be enhanced or different or more to what was in his original imagination, he would change it. Consequently, he would also get a lot of disagreement from his audiences. They would say, how come you took out that scene in the canteen when you had all those real people and you put in all those digital computer generated people? He did it because that was more of what he had in his head, but it affected the feedback that he got from a lot of his audience too. But that's a special case. He had control of all of his properties. And that's usually not the case with other people. As I said, theater is ephemeral. Once you perform the piece and you pull the curtain down, that's it. That singular performance that day with all the people that you sit there and watch it with is gone, right? Theater must be presented in the same space at the same time. The actors and the audience must be in the same space at the same time. I say this as not to belabor the point, but during the pandemic, we could not perform live things in groups. Our governor's harsh shutdown was like, you know, nobody, don't go outside, basically. And doing that is quite different. Even when we're here on Zoom, is still quite different because we are not in the same space. Right. So even though you can perform something or watch something on television, it's still not exactly the same. There is something electric when you're sitting there and an actor is like 5 feet away, 10 feet away. You're in the same theater looking at it and experience it. You will get a different type of sort of an electric feeling within yourself, an emotional connection that you won't get if you're just looking at something through a screen. As a consequence, we actually lost a grant because our grant was to take the show around to 8 different cities here in New Mexico. And we could only do the first 2 before the shutdown. And so we couldn't do the other 6 and we got our grant yanked out from under us. You can consider a theater piece as talk story on steroids. They're anecdotes that are dramatized, and the most effective ones have scholarship with facts that are presented within the story. So rather than saying, well, I think there were 144,000 Japanese, make sure that you've got all your facts right. So when you present them within the story, that there were at least 144,000 Japanese. The costs. Now, obviously you're gonna have the cost of time and you're gonna have a cost of scholarship. Now, whether these are all donated and to your project, that's neither here nor there. It's just something you have to work out with agreement. Royalties. For instance, again, I'm going to present this one scene from Farewell to Manzanar. Gene Wakatsuke gave our director and playwright carte blanche with presenting that scene we could do it without having to pay her any royalty. She was, and she'd come and saw our show, I think at least twice. And she was very happy with how we treated her material. Also, if you have any music that is put into your show that is not original, then you might have to pay royalties for that. Equipment. We usually like to go into places that will have a screen and a projector that we can hook up to a laptop, and thus we can show all of our slides, and we will have all of our sound cues. If you put sound cues into your thing, those will play. Otherwise, you have to cart that stuff with you. There were restrictions that we had in certain state buildings where if you perform something, they insist that everybody that's a performer have a microphone. So if the venue says, well, we have a microphone for the podium and we have one that we usually go out into the audience with, that's it. Then you have to bring in your own mics and your own system to wire up and plug into their system. That's a cost. Again, in 2020, we were slated to do 8 performances to go around New Mexico. The tour was supposed to go to Albuquerque, Santa Fe, Las Cruces, Silver City, Clovis, Gallup, Roswell, and Las Vegas. And if you know anything about New Mexico, we are the 5th largest state by land. So Albuquerque right there is in the center. It's an hour to get up to Santa Fe. It's about an hour and a half, 2 hours to go to Gallup. It's about an hour and a half to get to Las Vegas. It's about 2 or 3 hours to get to Clovis, depending on how you drive. And going all the way down to Las Cruces sometimes takes 4 or 5 hours, depending on traffic. To go to Silver City down there in the corner, you have to go through mountains. So it's very mountainous and takes about 5 hours to get to. So that's another cost. You're going to have gasoline if you're going to take it on the road. Theater is
Oh, hey, Rusty, I'm so sorry. Just in the interest of time, if you can kind of wrap this presentation like in like a next minute, we can come back to it if we have time in the Q&A session, but I certainly want to make sure we keep moving with the conversation.
Oh, okay. These are some pictures from our play. This is how we usually stage it. You put the actors in a semicircle, you have a screen behind them, and we have a narrator to move the action along. These are the kinds of slides that we can put up behind. At first, we start with the Chinese exclusion until, you know, when the Chinese were excluded, then they pulled in the Japanese after them as labor. You don't have to have everybody be exactly what's being depicted. So in this instance, Eric Shimamoto right here in the, he has he's down in the front. He is part Japanese, part white. Joan Varney next to him is also part Japanese, part white. Aiko Allen, she is part Japanese, part Native American. And our narrator was a white gentleman. And we can come back and I will show the video later.
Yeah, well, thank you, Rusty. I mean, we want to make sure there's some time for Q&A for the audience. So, you know, I think you gave a really great presentation of some of the nuts and bolts that a lot of people may not, you know, realize that go behind the storytelling. But at the same time, I don't want to scare people away from doing plays and putting on productions. I used to direct plays myself and had written several plays. And so I know the power of, you know, everything that a play, and many of you have listed musicals and plays as being some of those memorable experiences. So you also know the power of that storytelling. As we kind of move into film, which, as Rusty mentioned, is in a different space where we make the film, and then sometimes it takes years. In our case, we made Far East, Deep South. We spent almost six years from the time we stepped into Mississippi for the first time to make the film into its fruition, and then goes a journey of getting it to people and to audiences to actually seeing it, and not all audiences get to see it at the same time. But we want to show you, for those of you who are not familiar with Far East, Deep South, we want to show a trailer for the film. And Baldwin, tell them about Rusty's interesting connection to our film.
Yeah, I mean, you just heard Rusty's working on all these on his play and everything. But Rusty is actually, his mom is past national president for CACA, Carolyn Chan. So we have a tie-in with Rusty. And as you'll see in the trailer here, we get a special sneak peek and appearance from our very own Carolyn Chan. Growing up, it was always kind of a mystery about my dad and his side of the family. Whenever my brother and I would ask him about my grandfather, he would just say, oh, it's a sad story, it's not a big deal. One day we came across this photo of a gravestone, and that's when my dad finally told us that this is where my grandfather and great-grandfather were buried. But not in China, in Mississippi.
Chinese people in Mississippi? What happened there?
I actually don't know where we are going and where we're going.
Last thing I thought I'd ever find in Mississippi was a Chinese museum.
I guess there was more than just my grandfather and my great-grandfather.
When the Chinese first came to the Delta, they were treated like we were.
Everything was very segregated. I mean, it was black, white. We were just really in the middle.
I had to attend a segregated one-room schoolhouse.
Growing up, I read about segregation, and I thought that it only affected the black community.
I just didn't really think that it happened to the Chinese, too.
What?
Great-grandpa!
Oh, my God! Family.
It is so important for people to know what happened with the Chinese Exclusion Act and how it affected Chinese Americans throughout the nation, including the South.
Might be on mute.
There we go. Sorry. So that's the trailer for Far East Deep South, and you might have seen that there's a lot of CACA members. There's several of them that are in our film.
Oh yeah, and well, the important thing about I think what we did is we didn't actually set out to make a movie initially. We took a family trip. And once it was evident of kind of the things that happened, we decided to construct a story, or I mean, it's a documentary. So, but there are still story elements in filmmaking, even if it's a documentary. I could have done a straight up, you know, historical interviews with just experts, but we decided to make this story told through the eyes of the family and their experiences as they happened, and really it being a very immersive experience while people learn quite a bit of history. Mm-hmm. So Baldwin, can you tell us a little bit more about the journey that Far East Deep South has taken? We heard a little bit about Rusty's journey with his play. What has been the impact and the journey?
Yeah, I mean, definitely took a lot longer. And as we made this journey, we were able to actually do something that I'd never thought we'd be able to do. We'd made old grown men cry, Chinese grown men cry, not just my dad's, but you know, one of the things that we've been able to do is there's been some diversity events where companies and schools and organizations wanted to show people what Asian American history is and some of the different things that they haven't heard before. So as they were showing our films, one of the things we've had many people do was a lot of men were saying like they were crying. And this was like the first time they would actually say that that the story was so impactful in their life that it made them think about their own lives and it made them think about their own families. So I think the main impact that we've seen our film do is that it has had a lot of people think back about their own lives. And for those that were not Asian, it's been remarkable because we had so many non-Asian people say, wow, we never thought of the Asian community like this. It blew away all of our stereotypes. And we've even had some say, like, you know, this film and films like this and stories like this for the first time has humanized a face like this to people that don't generally hang around people that look like us or are Asian.
Well, one of the things that's been interesting is we were talking about the pandemic earlier, and, you know, poor Rusty's play hasn't been able to do performances because of the pandemic that were canceled. The one advantage in terms of the film that we thought, you know, initially was a detriment was like, oh no, all the theaters are shut down. We were doing all these film festivals. And yet we were able to translate this viewing experience, although we still prefer a theater or a room full of people watching a movie. We were able to at least share the film. Can you talk a little bit about some of those community engagements in a virtual space and also some of the diversity panels that we've been a part of?
Yeah, one of the things that has been kind of shocking, but a great surprise is that some of these corporations that are doing these panels, we thought maybe it'd be an API group or something like that, where you would have you grab as many Asian Americans that are part of this company or this community, and they would come to this event and they would watch this Asian American film. But we classified this as an American film and not an Asian American film. So some of these companies were actually predominantly non-Asian. We actually spoke on a panel in Wisconsin, somewhere up there, where there was one person that was Asian American and everyone else was not. And so the stories that we've been able to share, our story that we've been able to share is, it has been great because the communities that are not Asian are learning about Asian Americans for the very first time. And a lot of the comments are, we never learned about this in school. We don't even have any Asian friends. We don't even have any Asian neighbors. Yet we watch your film and it relates to us. And this has been in the Black community and been in a white community as well.
Well, I think one of the things that's been interesting is we've had this opportunity with the film because we talk about the intersection between the Black community and the Chinese community in the segregated South. And so especially with a lot of community groups, even churches and with ERG groups within companies, they've actually had like African American groups join in with the Asian American groups and doing kind of joint events. And so, you know, I think storytelling is an effective way where maybe somebody, you know, didn't think about like the intersection between these communities. You know, just like Rusty was saying, it's like nobody knew that there was camps in New Mexico. Like you're all of a sudden, oh, it relates to you on a different level because you can make that community connection with another group you never thought, right? Mm-hmm. And we've had a lot of response from schools as well. Talk about the school and the education campaign with that.
Yeah, and Rusty touched on this a little bit too, and it's absolutely the truth is where it's so hard to change curriculum, but it was so much easier to show a film and have a teacher say, oh wow, I could totally supplement my curriculum with this film. So I'm going to do that. And we've had schools where they showed it in their class. We've had a school where they showed it to the entire school over the pandemic, right towards the end of last school year, and said like, hey, we're having a rise in Asian hate. We've had some issues in our school. We're gonna bring this film in and talk about it. And they had the entire school and they invited their parents to come. And the school is saying, hey, you know, we don't have this in our curriculum, but we have this film. And so we've been able to not only show our film, but also suggest other films that are also about Asian American history for those classes.
We wanted to show you some quotes here, just a couple quotes from some students.
You're on the wrong one.
Can you guys see the quotes? I should be. Can you guys see the quotes from the students on the screen? Or is it showing something else?
Is it showing a flag or is it showing the quote?
We see quotes.
You see quotes, yeah. Yes. So my view of Chinese in America has changed majorly. I never knew they had the Chinese Exclusion Act that picked them out personally to be deported. If anything, they faced as much racism and segregation as the Black community did down in Mississippi. And these are from high school students from a high school in Oregon.
Which are predominantly non-Asian.
And this film has really opened my eyes about the many difficulties and hardships the Chinese had when they first came to the US. And so we believe that watching a film like ours has made a very memorable impression on these students that hopefully they will take with them for a lifetime. And lastly, we have, sorry about that. I just undid my presentation, and we have a big announcement to make before we continue with our conversation. A few people were asking about our film and where they could see it. Sorry, I'm having some issues here with the computer. You guys are among the first to hear this, but some of you have watched Far East Deep South, and we appreciate all the different lodges and their support when we had broadcast in PBS in May. So there's an encore presentation of Far East Deep South that is coming September 14th to PBS World Channel. You'll have to check your local listings. It's 8, 7 Central, depending on where you are. If you're in the Pacific time, it's going to be, the first airing will be 5 p.m. and there'll normally be multiple airings. And then it'll be streaming for 30 days after September 14th. And this is part of a back to school campaign so that hopefully teachers and lodges, you can organize watch parties around this and even more family members. And hopefully it's a catalyst to talk about a lot of these issues. That's something we wanted to share with you.
I think you're still sharing screen.
I'm still sharing the screen. Okay. Let me stop sharing the screen and we'll continue on with our conversation. You know, the power of storytelling inspires others to tell their stories. And I know we want to leave a little time for Q&A if people have any questions, but we're going to get back to Rusty here. I know he has a clip that, if we had some clips he wanted to share, because one of the, you know, this is a narrative film, right, Rusty, from Farewell to Manzanar, is that correct? Or are you showing a different clip?
Turn on your mic, Rusty.
Oh, Rusty. Was that your mother?
Yes.
Listen to your mom.
Mother
Listen
always is still. Unmute yourself, Rusty.
Rusty, you're still muted.
Okay, sorry.
Right.
Okay, here we go. This is 2 minutes into it. It's an interrogation scene between Jean's father and an army lieutenant. And her father was a fisherman. And so the guy was asking him about that he was providing aid and comfort to the Japanese Navy.
Sad for both countries. It is a kind of thing that always happens when the military men are in control.
What do you think of the American military? Would you object to your son serving?
Yes, I would protest. The American military is just like the Japanese.
What do you mean?
They also want to make war when it is not necessary. As long as military men are in control, you're always going to have war.
Who do you think will win this one?
America, of course. It is richer, has more resources, more weapons, more people. The Japanese are courageous fighters, and they will fight well. But their leaders are stupid. Every night I reach my country.
You say Japan is still your country.
I was born there. I still have relatives living there. In many ways, yet it is still my country.
You feel any loyalty to Japan or its emperor? I say, do you feel any loyalty to Japan?
How old are you?
29.
When were you born?
I'm the interrogator here, Mr. Wazuki, not you.
I'm interested to know when you were born.
1913.
I have been living in this country 9 years longer than you have. Do you realize that? Yet I am prevented by law from becoming a citizen. I am prevented by law from owning land. I am now separated from my family without cause.
Whose matters are out of my hand, Mr. Wazuki?
Well, whose hands are they in?
I do not like North Dakota any more than you do. The sooner we finish these questions, the sooner we'll both be out of here.
And where will you go when you leave?
Who do you want to win the war?
I'm interested to know where you will be going when you leave.
Mr. Mizuki, if I have to repeat each one of these questions, we will be here forever. Who do you want to win the war?
When your mother and father are fighting, do you want them to kill each other? Or do you just want to stop fighting?
Thanks, Rusty. Can you share a little bit more about, and was that scene done just during this pandemic? Was that done on Zoom? Is that, so that's a recreation of a scene from the original Farewell to Manzanar, correct?
Right, that's a recreation of the scene specifically for the, I had a friend of mine, he and I did this earlier this week, just as an example to show you what incorporating someone else's work into your work. Like I said, it's from Gene Wachowski's memoir. They did it in a movie. You can watch the movie and actually see how the scene played out there. But we incorporated it into our show.
That's great. I love how even though it's on a video, you can kind of still feel the power of the story and the characters. And I can imagine how much more powerful that is to see that in person. You know, another way we had mentioned about telling stories is even through short form, when we're talking about like videos. And somebody had mentioned earlier that Hamilton was one of those memorable movies or musicals that there's a stage version on Disney Plus now that was filmed. And of course, most people are learning about our founding fathers and the Revolutionary War through Hamilton. We did a twist on Hamilton that we're going to show a little bit of. That is our twist on Asian American history, as Asian Americans make history.
There's nothing that our country needs more than learning our history and who came to our shores. The first Asians came to this land in 1587, broke their backs working with their hands, indentured servants, and even slaves. But quietly, this country was paved. Exclusion laws tried to suppress and kick us. Huh. We fought for you, America. All we did was
work in the mines.
Work.
Plantations.
Yes, cotton fields.
History's coming.
They brought us here.
Needed us.
So we can.
History says that we didn't do much. History doesn't really know. People say history can't be touched, but there's a lot it doesn't show. Look around, look around. A revolution is happening around us.
So let us
make history
work.
It's bad enough people say we don't belong. People shouting in the square. It's bad enough they don't care that they're wrong. Blaming us, it's just not fair. Look around, look around.
Larissa, remind me what we're looking for.
We're looking for truth. People we devoted our lives to.
Work, work.
Irrigated the farms to.
Work, work.
Left our homes so that we can.
Work, work.
There's nothing like sweating in the city, except no one ever stopped or paused to call us pretty. Excuse me, miss, I know about the railroads. Left out of the pictures now, where did we all go? They said we ate rats, today they say bats. They aiming to be blaming when they're saying all that.
And they thought it was funny.
Took all of their money, blew up our daddies and mines. Goodbye, sonny.
I've been reading Common Sense by Thomas Paine. So men say that I'm intense or I'm insane.
You want a revolution, I want a revelation. So listen to my declaration.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
And when I meet Thomas Jefferson, I'ma compel him to include Asians in the sequel.
Work!
Look around, fought the wars. How lucky we are to be alive right now. Look around for generations. How lucky we are to be alive right now.
History is happening, it's been happening. We just happen to be the most diverse country in the world. Diverse country in the world.
Look around, cross the seas. How lucky we are to be alive right now. Look around, created jobs. How lucky we are to be alive right now.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
Look around, look around.
How lucky we are to be alive right now.
Okay.
Oops. I'm trying to stop this.
All right. In the interest of time, we are not going to be able to show the whole video, but we just wanted to give you the taste. I will drop the link in there in a little bit with the full video if you want to see it. But I know time is short and we want to get to some questions. If you do have questions, please feel free to put it in the chat at this time. And we will get to those questions in the brief amount. We have about like 5 minutes left before we have to close. Rusty, if people want to find out more about your play or even maybe get in contact with you, or they may be considering it, bring it to their school or their town, how can people learn more or contact you, Rusty?
Can contact me at abqtrc@aol.com. It's up in limbo as to how it's going to be. Probably no performances this year, but maybe next year. And I'm working with a producer to see about performing some of the scenes actually on film, just to have some clips and things for people. And so I can let people know if we're able to complete that.
I think that's a great idea in interim, as we're kind of waiting out this pandemic, to get creative of how we can tell our stories. So Rusty Chance, his email is in there. And Baldwin, how can people connect with us if they want to find out more about our film and stay in the know? Oh, you know, let me get my
they can answer. You can definitely just go to fareastdeepsouth.com. You can see it in our backdrop here. There's also social media at Far East Deep South for Facebook and Instagram, Far East Deep So on Twitter, ran out of letters. And definitely, we just want to really encourage you all to just look at your own creativity. And you don't have to make a film, you don't have to make a play, but everyone is creative in their own ways. Even when we brought Asian American history to our school for the first time for API History Month, it was the first time that anyone has, our school has ever done it, and everyone just used creative ways to tell stories. So definitely want to encourage you to use storytelling in education.
Yeah, and we'd love to partner with any lodges in doing screenings, or, we'll be sending out, I think, more information. You mentioned subscribing to our email newsletter, organizing watch parties around the PBS broadcast or on the streaming, and doing discussions even beyond the PBS window. We're excited to do that. And let me check the chat here. We're going to open up time for we have a couple minutes to do for some questions that we might have. Do we have any questions from the audience? You can also unmute yourself, since we're a relatively small group, so to speak. We're 51 strong, but if anybody has any questions on Rusty's project or our project or
in general.
Storytelling in general, feel free to unmute yourself.
I have a question. I'm just wondering, this process was 5 years. How does a filmmaker know during that time what will be important as they are filming? I know that you edit, but over a 5-year period, how much are you going to film and then decide that you're going to, keep?
That is a great question. And I see our fellow filmmaker, Kenning here as well. He knows there's hundreds of hours of footage that is left on the cutting room floor. When we set out to make the film, it was more of a family trip documenting. And those of you who've seen our film, some of the discoveries we made along the way, from going to the National Archives and discovering Baldwin's family's Chinese exclusion files, that was not in our plan. In fact, that actually added time to making our movie, because all of a sudden I had to change the way the whole film, right? Because it was more focused on just the Chinese in Mississippi and the experiences in the Delta. And then once we discovered Baldwin's family's lineage stretched now like 5 generations in this country, the film kind of took on a, even though we still have that very important part of the Mississippi Delta Chinese in there, it became more about American identity and our role and how strong the lineage of Baldwin's family, was. So We don't necessarily know. I mean, there's some filmmakers, like say you're doing during a film on whales, like you have kind of a more focused subject. You can kind of set out to like, we're gonna study whales for a year and see their breeding patterns or something. Like that's much more focused, where we really knew we were following nothing. Baldwin's family.
nothing.
We wanted to incorporate a lot of the stories, and we got in as much as we could. Sue Ellen has a question.
Yeah, that was wonderful. And then I know you have, you know, very, very excellent presentation to the schools. Is any way or you have encountered that your film inspire or collaborate with this classroom? So encourage the young people to do their own filming project to chase their family history.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that is in our new discussion guide that we'll be releasing. That is kind of one of the activities that we suggest. And I know Charles Mao, I think, is on here too. I mean, we had talked at CAC, I think we've talked about doing a video contest. And so, you know, maybe it's time to revive that idea and to try to do that as something to encourage students.
We also showed our film at a school, which was full of filmmakers. And we were talking about how using film to create documentaries can actually add to their curriculum. And a lot of the students were very interested after seeing our film and having our discussion about how they could also create content about other historical stories.
Yeah, but empowering others to tell their story and inspiring others to tell their story, I think is very important component of what we're doing. And I know what Rusty's doing as well.
Yeah, now in this digital age, I think there's a lot more opportunities for us.
Yeah, well, we want to thank everyone for joining us for this session. Thank you, Rusty, for sharing all about your amazing play, and I really hope we get a chance to see it in real life. And hope people will check out Far East Deep South September 14th and beyond. Or if you're going to be in Phoenix, I know there's a few Phoenix people here, you're going to see Baldwin tomorrow in Phoenix. He's driving first thing in the morning. There's three
early
screenings at the Phoenix Film Festival this weekend, Saturday through Monday. And I'm going to hand it back over to our president, Melanie.
thank
you all.
I want to extend my warmest thanks to Rusty and Larissa and Baldwin. You know, I think you guys have really showcased how we can, another way to tell the stories where the words are not necessarily the focus, but I think it inspires the emotion in the audience and the people. And it is a way to kind of bridge that gap, right? That otherwise might not be bridged anywhere way else. So thank you so much. We are at time. We are going to be ending this Zoom call and going on to our next call, which is laying the foundation for AAPI studies. So I hope to see everybody on our next Zoom call. Thank you again, everybody.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.